Good time? Again, for all of you, welcome to Brookfield and Brookfield Town Hall. Ed is always a dollar short or day late or whatever, but nice to have you here, Ed. Thank you. Again, thank you for coming and joining into this conversation this evening. I put a little agenda, a couple of slides together to kind of give you what we're about to do. Just logistically, there's a restroom just across the hall, and that is the only one in town. So anyway, another story for another day. But anyway, there is a restroom across the hall if you need it.
And the light switch is higher than you'd expect.
Oh, well, we try. They didn't have electricity when they built this building. Anyway, so we're going to do some introductions. I'm Clarence Snyder, and I'm your local project chairman, coordinator, whatever, also a selectman here in town. I'm going to give you some background of how we got here tonight, and then I'm going to turn the program over to Eric Johnson and Kit as far as the background and historical piece, and then we'll see how you might be able to help us, and then we'll do a closing. But I would be remiss if I did not thank the folks that are here this evening and have been supportive through the activities, and just come on in, it's okay. It's all right. Grab a chair. You don't have to stand. Good. Got plenty of room over here. All right. You're on camera. Your boss knows you're here. Anyway, it would be remiss of me not to do some introductions. Again, Eric Johnson here at the table with me. And Kit Curran is sitting over there. She's got a cold and doesn't want to contaminate me because my wife is going away, and if I give my wife a cold, I'm going to get shot. So anyway, but I put a few, and you see this thing, the names fill up as far as the folks that have helped this activity. I didn't see Ron Kucher come into the room, but Ron was really instrumental in protecting the site that we're going to be talking about for a number of years. And again, we have to give Ron some credit, but the highway department has just been terrific. A year ago, the site was a mess, and with the highway department's efforts, along with a lot of volunteers, and again, Bruce Clark isn't here this evening, but Kermit, perfect timing. That's Bruce. He can run a machine and then some. Kermit Eaton is in the front row. He kind of was the chairperson of the volunteers down at the site. Emery Manning, the chairman of the cemetery. Emery, you're here somewhere. Up in the back row. Tom Morse is here in the front row. He's been our Indian representative. And again, we have to look to Tom for the cooperation that we've gotten from the Native population to help us be where we are. It's good stuff. Carol Plume is not here, but
I saw.
You snuck in. How'd you do that? I was looking for you. Carol Plume from the Historical Society. Thank you, Carol, again. And if you ever want to know where the intersection of the rivers are, you just go to Carol's house. Again, Clarence Snyder and Cindy Thompson has been helping us with the contract activities. So I'm going to put a map up on the wall that you can see that we're really talking about the I-90, 290 exchange from 1,000 years before Christ. Come on in. And to take a minute, yep, we're going to get Rudy a front row seat. I got a front row seat for you, Rudy.
I'll go sit up. I promise to not be
blind. Almost impossible for Rudy. Anyway. With that, I just want to get a little background of how we got, or the town has gotten to the point that we are. Again, I was elected as a selectman a year and a half ago, and with that, we were looking at the properties in town that had lost money. How could we put properties back onto the tax rolls? And the number one or two property, depending on how you wanted to look at it, was in fact the campground property. And there are a bunch of people in this area or in this town that would like to have that property put back on the tax rolls. But in our research of what went on there, and again, with Ron Kucher's background as far as what has happened, it's something that we needed to do, what we're about to do, as far as the study and understanding of the indigenous population that lived in and around the lakes, again, going back to 1,000 years before Christ. And again, I turn to Eric for, I am not an archaeologist, engineer by trade, but I turn to Eric to keep us straight as far as what's going on, as far as the history of what we're doing. But it's a really important time for not only Brookfield, and yes, that's where the campground is located, but from what I've learned, it's this whole area. And again, thank you for coming down from the north and from the east and from the west, because we're all kind of connected by what we're about to talk about. Eric, is that close enough for you?
That's
to
good.
You want me to switch things?
Yeah, if you could. Go.
All right.
All right, so I'll talk a little bit. You've heard this referred to as an Adena-Connected burial ground. So I just want to talk a little bit about what that means, and then talk about our project and what we'd like to do for the town, who is, after all, our client. Adena is a term that archaeologists use to refer to the material record of Native Americans who lived in the Ohio River Valley between about 1000 BC and AD 100. There we go. So here's a map showing you the United States, part of it anyway, Adena in the Ohio River Valley, the geographic heartland of Adena. And the map also shows you, there we go, this lighter brown area is the extent of a later culture archaeologists call Hopewell that shares many similarities with Adena. Well, Adena is the first of what many people refer to as the mound builders, because one of the things that they did was build these large earthen mounds. And this is just one example. There are thousands of them. And many of them have been destroyed. People leveled them because they wanted to plant crops and not have to pull a plow over a hill. But a lot of them have been preserved in Ohio, and the Adena people buried their dead in these mounds. And often they buried them inside of tombs made from timbers that were underneath these mounds, accompanied by tools, ornaments, other objects that had important meanings to them. And later mound builder cultures include Hopewell, this is what archaeologists call them, Mississippian, and a number of tribes in southeastern United States were still building mounds and using them when the first European travelers intruded into their lands. So they were the first of the people sometimes known as mound builders. Some of the characteristic artifacts of Adena are the Adena spear points. They're large, well-made, flaked stone points with these robust stems. Often the stem is, this is a straight stem, but this is a really typical lobate stem, we call that. They're big, substantial spear points.
How large is large?
Let's see if I got a scale here. No, of course not. I would say large is about 6 to 8 inches long. Some Adena pottery. They made these sort of cylindrical shaped flat-bottomed pots, often decorated with this kind of geometric design, sometimes stylized animal designs. And one of the really interesting items, artifacts associated with Adena, are these tubular pipes. They were often buried with the dead. And remember that smoking, especially tobacco, was and is today very important in all kinds of ceremony and ritual among indigenous people all over North America. And the appearance of those pipes may represent the roots of those rituals. They're thought to be modeled, these are particularly fancy ones that are carved in the shape of a duck in this case. duck, I'm not sure what that is, some kind of a mammal, but the duck is an important figure in origin stories among many of the tribes. So the model that these are based on, so these are hollow tubes, a little hole in the end. It's based on a piece of cane, a section of cane that would be made into a pipe. And, you know, it would be filled with tobacco, a little hole in it, and it would be used to smoke. But these are carved out of stone. And these are very characteristic Adena artifacts. They're called tablets, and they are actually flat slabs of stone that are carved, and they often have traces of pigment on them. And they're thought to have been used to print on textiles. Of course, the textiles are long gone. They don't survive in the ground, but these tablets do. A lot of the, and the really interesting artwork on them, a lot of the tablets have this sort of bird, or it's called a raptor, you know, a hawk or an eagle. You can see the head, the talons here. This is a wing and this is a tail. And that kind of design is on many of the Adena tablets. And just to continue, we'll move out of Ohio soon. This is an image from the Ohio Historical Society of an Adena village. So the archaeological evidence from the Ohio Valley suggests that people lived in villages, and they did not grow maize or beans, but they grew crops of sunflowers and other seed plants that were native to the Ohio Valley and the Mississippi Valley, squashes, and also hunted and gathered and fished. And they obviously worked well together to observe this rich ceremonial life that included the building of these mounds. They did beautiful work in stone, ceramics, probably textiles. There's no evidence in Adena society, from the archaeological evidence, that there's some kind of supreme ruler who is ordering their people to build these mounds. It seems like they're a collective effort that everybody participated in. So you don't see some house that's larger than all the others, or a grave that's far richer than all the others. It seems like a more or less a egalitarian society. So how does that bring us to Brookfield? Well, in 1963, Adena-related artifacts, including a spear point and tubular pipes, were found here in Brookfield at the campground property we're talking about tonight. This is about as far east as any Adena artifacts have been found. They're very rare in Massachusetts. There's a large site on Lake Champlain in Vermont that has a number of Adena-related artifacts and a few others, but these are drawings of the artifacts that Barker Keith found. So Barker Keith excavated graves at this site in 1963. They were exposed when some pipes were put in, and then he went in and recovered artifacts and parts of skeletons from this site. Now this was done, you know, in Barker's defense, this was done before attitudes among archaeologists, both professional and amateur, underwent a big change. And so today, we wouldn't do this. We would not disturb graves. Whenever graves are excavated, it's when they've been partially destroyed already, and there's a procedure whereby the Massachusetts Commission on Indian Affairs participates with the state archaeologist and the landowner to try to figure out if it's possible that those bones could be returned and left alone. If not, if they could be reburied someplace very close to their original resting place. And ultimately, it's the decision of the Commission on Indian Affairs, which is representatives from all the major tribes in Massachusetts, to decide what the disposition of human remains. So now the goal is to protect burials, to preserve them. or to repatriate them, return them to the tribes if they've already been excavated. And these artifacts and the human remains that Barker Keith had went to the Springfield Museum, and from there they were repatriated and reburied by representatives of the Narragansett, Stockbridge, Munsee, and Aquinna tribes. So our intention here is to get information.
Did you say that they've been returned?
They've been reburied, yes.
How long ago was that?
Very recently, last fall.
The entire collection?
The funerary objects, as they were described to me. So Barker Keith had a large collection, but not all of it was from these burials. So the other materials that he found in his yard and other places, I believe those are still at the Springfield Museum.
The two female skeletons that were found in Maine finally, you know about those?
Nope, but I'm here to learn.
Make sure you sign up, Carol. You want to make sure that Eric has your contact.
Yeah, so our intent here is not to excavate or disturb graves in any way, to gather information on where they were found and where others may be, but not by digging them up. So tonight I want to tell you a bit about our general goals. Here's our property here. This is what we intend to do for the town. And I'll tell you what we're going to do, and then I would also like to listen to what people have to say. You know, you are our clients, and we hope to learn from you in information that is going to help us to do a better job for you.
Excuse me, Eric.
Yes?
Can you start by describing our location?
Oh, okay. So this is the property in question. It's an old campground on the northwestern shore of Quabog Pond. The outlet to the Quabog River is right here. I have a few other maps, but I don't know whether they really pull back to show you the pond. We have maps up here that people can look at. Pine Lane right here, and
Hobbs,
right here. So, like I said, one of our goals is get as much information as we can about the property to help the town manage the property. We want to know where archaeological sites are or where we think they are likely to be. Not just burials, but there may very well be living sites here. I mean, it wouldn't really surprise me in the least. Where Nipmuc people and their ancestors may have lived. And you know, obviously we're not out there digging right now, but we have already started some archival research that can be done no matter what the weather's like. So
before you leave that map, do you know where Barker found what he found? What in what area of the campground?
We have an idea, and I think that we will be able to get a much more precise idea when we've talked to people and looked into that more. So when in the 1980s, I actually met Barker Keith. I was working for the Massachusetts Historical Commission on a project where we went around the state and we interviewed people who had archaeological collections of artifacts, and asked them where they found them. We actually inventoried their collections. So we filled out endless forms of what types of artifacts they had found at what places. We found thousands of sites. We didn't find them, they had already been found. And people had collected artifacts from them, but we were able to put all that information into a database. And so Barker Keith was one of the people we met, and you know, it was pretty clear right away, there's a real character. So he showed us his collection, we inventoried it, and he wasn't all that mobile at that time. But I think he did take us down the street and kind of pointed in the direction to where he had done this excavation. So to get this information, we're going to follow several paths. archival research I mentioned already, and community research. We're going to listen to what people in town remember or have to say or think about this place and really the whole area, the whole region. If you have information about other sites, that's very interesting too. And then we're going to do some careful, limited archaeological testing. So we're going to carefully remove thin layers of the topsoil, and so we can see the subsoil beneath it. Now, if a hole has been dug and filled in, we should be able to distinguish that without digging into it from the surrounding undisturbed soils. But we're not going to then excavate the graves. Or if it's a feature that's not a grave, like a hearth feature, we're not going to excavate it. Just going to note that it's there and then cover it up again. So they will be preserved. One of our final deliverables will also be to create a base map of this whole property that identifies where everything is as precisely as we're able to identify it, and then also where we don't think there's going to be any kind of material, any kind of cultural material, like the swimming pool, for example. That's one you can recognize really quickly. Another goal is to secure national recognition and commemoration for the site. We're going to do that by filling out and filing a National Register nomination form. It's not like filling out a one-page form to renew your license. It's a federal government form, quite time-consuming and challenging to fill out. I've done a number of them. We are confident that it will be listed in the National Register of Historic Places. And that's national recognition of the historical significance of this site. And the sort of other things that National Register listing does is it makes the town, the owner of the site, eligible to get grants to perhaps clean it up a bit more or protect it, some protective measures that cost money. So that's another possibility for National Register. But really, the big thing with National Register, it's recognition. And then the last of our goals is to prepare educational materials, because we think this is a really great opportunity, excuse, and source of information from which we can pull together detailed recommendations and maybe examples and resources for the public schools in Brookfield and about Native American history and about archaeology. So I mentioned we already started archival research. I'll just give you a little taste of what Kit was able to turn up in a matter of hours. A 2013 aerial photo of the campground. There's the swimming pool, the main entrance up here, and this sort of emergency entrance there. This is this building and this sort of central area here. So that's what it looks like today. This aerial photo is from 1966. So this was just 3 years after Barker Keith did his excavations. And you can see it's very different. There's no swimming pool, and there's this large building and this big open area, and we think it's somewhere in here where he was digging. And just sort of go back. See the changes that have gone on there. This is a LIDAR map. So LIDAR is a laser imaging method that fires billions of laser pulses at the ground, and it gives you a very precise high resolution topographical map. And you can get LIDAR maps for all of Massachusetts? Is that right?
You can get the point of data for most of Massachusetts.
Most of Massachusetts now, from MassGIS. Here's the swimming pool, and then this light area is higher elevation, and the darker areas are lower elevation. So that could be an interesting indication of where people may have wanted to live or where they may have buried their dead, not in the lower lying areas, but higher up. I mean, there's no mound here. And it's my feeling that it's most likely that what we're looking at is Adena artifacts that are being traded here into Massachusetts and used by the people who are living here. And then, just one more. Combining the LIDAR with the 1966 aerial photo, you can see that here's the edge of this sort of raised area right in here. And this is, it's in here where we believe that Barker Keith was digging. Doesn't mean that other areas of this property aren't, you know, don't have a lot of archaeological potential, historical potential. That's what we're going to be looking into. All right, so I've finished my talk, and I'd like to just talk about
what you know.
Will you be able to use ground penetrating radar?
We won't be using ground penetrating radar because the scope of work from the Mass Historical Commission did not include ground penetrating radar. They're not big believers in ground penetrating radar. The reason they don't like it is because it gives false positives and false negatives. And while that's true, it also gives true positives and true negatives. But what you have to do is then go in and start testing what you've identified with ground penetrating radar, so it doesn't tell you what everything is. It has to be ground truth, as we call it. So they did not want ground penetrating radar to be used. So we're not using it.
How far away would the village be from a typical burial ground?
That's a really good question. And I don't know the answer to that. But, I mean, obviously, not too far. And there are definitely, I mean, this is a spot where a lot of people would be living, right across the river, perhaps?
I own land on the other side, on the southeast side of Quabog Lake, and all of the period maps show it was the ancient Indian site there. And Barker Keith, I know for a fact, because I bought that land in the 1960s. I know Barker Keith was digging there on my site, right overlooking the lake. There was the summer site.
Is that the Oak Home site?
No, not the Oak Home site.
Jepson's site?
Yeah, Jepson's. No, that's no. Jepson's is the Oak Home site.
Okay, I'm trying to remember.
I'm on the other side.
Is that the southeast lower corner?
Southeast.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, so I have a ton of artifacts. I have 400 artifacts.
Well, we'd love to look at them.
I want you to look at them because I recognize when you show the Adena projectile points, I recognize some of those that I had. So, and that could have been the village site, and they went across the lake to bury the dead because, you know, maybe
that's
superstitious.
That's certainly plausible.
And I've been trying to save this land for since 1989, and it's been an impossible task because it takes a lot of money because it's land for development. In fact, I've kept it under development threat for because I'm a contractor, and I've kept it under that threat for 20 years. So I've got a new plan that will save that piece of land that I have left. I have 58 to 60 acres, virgin. Not a lot of digging that's been going on from archaeologists. Barker Keith was mostly on the lake front. Mm-hmm. So I pretty much know where all the artifacts are up there because I did my own little survey, and carefully. And it's just loaded. I mean, you could probably come out of there with 8,000 to 10,000 artifacts. Is that much of it?
On the East Brookfield side.
On the East Brookfield side, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if we need to do a project like
that. And I've had EAA out there, Central Mass Regional Planning Commission, I've had everybody out there. But no money. Mm-hmm. No money to do it. But I might have a benefactor. The guy's a billionaire, so I may have a benefactor, and I may be able to save this whole thing. I'm hoping. That I, in the next few months, is what I'm hoping. I'm working hard at it. So, but I even brought some artifacts with me in this little box.
All right, well, yeah, we'd love to take a look at them afterwards.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Question, Pete.
When this campground was being considered to be built, was there any documentation of an Indian burial ground or a village there?
There's none that I'm aware of, but that doesn't mean that documentation isn't out there. So that's definitely something we'd be very interested in finding.
I'm wondering.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, the question is, when that campground was originally developed, was there information of that being a Native American village or burial ground? Was it known then? And to the best of my knowledge, I'm not aware of any of that. But, you know, I just don't know.
Well, one of the other things, Eric, in the 1880s, this area that we're talking about was known as the Oakland Gardens. Mm-hmm. In fact, there was a baseball diamond there.
That's right, you were famous. Tell me about
story about Connie Mack playing his last amateur game on this diamond at that time. So, Ward's Beach was what the name of the beach was at that time, there probably wasn't a great deal of understanding of what was there before that time. It was really Parker Keith about that time.
So there was no documentation that you
would have. Not that I found.
Yes.
Was there any indication of red ochre or any sort of?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, so Barker wrote up his findings, a very brief article in the Bulletin of the Massachusetts Archaeological Society, and he did mention red ochre.
Oh.
Copper beads, shell beads, the artifacts pictured in the
any cremation?
I don't think so. I'm trying to remember. I don't think there were any cremations. Yes.
1885 map shows that as a lakeside park.
Is that the one you were mentioning?
Yes, that's also the
Oakland. You have that information that we'll want to bring out as well.
Oakland Gardens was part of that lakeside park.
It's always good to know what's been going on the last few centuries, because that affects what's left over from those activities. But it seems like, you know, even with the baseball field there, there's a lot left underground. Yes?
Hi, Eric. I don't know if you remember me. I'm Joe Craig.
Joe, hi. Oh, it's great to see you again.
30-some-odd years since you're at the house recording my collection. But in answer to Mr. White's question, I knew Barker very well, and I had the tour with him a couple times of the campground, mm-hmm. showing me where the site was. Can I remember it to the detail? No, I cannot today. But he was telling me, because he's been going there since he was a young lad,
mm-hmm.
and I mentioned one time to him if he had any recognition, any recording from anyone that there were artifacts found there before this particular Adena site, and he said no.
Hmm.
Now, Barker did a lot of searching on the field. There was one back on the right side beyond the campground, and on the left side where there's condos today. And those were fields that were plowed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he found a lot of artifacts there. As a matter of fact, where the condos are today, he said if ever they dig that up, get in there. Well, they did. And I walked in there, and they had all the topsoil piled up like mountains. And I wanted to walk that. And the contractors were there, and they refused to let me get on the property because of liability.
Mm-hmm.
But, but I can cross the lake. You know what I have in my collection at the museum? When you cross the lake and get on the other side,
mm-hmm.
The 10,000 items I donated to the museum, I bet one-third of that was found on the other side of the lake.
Mm-hmm.
But I had quite a walk with Barker at that time. This would have been back in the late 70s,
okay,
when I went through there with Barker, him showing me. It was all camp, all trailers in there. So it's changed.
Mm-hmm.
It's good to see you again.
Yeah, it's great to see you all. You catch up a little bit after the meeting.
What's that?
Catch up a little bit after the meeting.
Yes.
Yes.
It's going to be interesting to find out what we see in there, because that was a five-star campground after all this was, whatever was played in there, whatever. It's going to be interesting to see. There was a $250,000 bus campus that was parked in there. It was pretty loaded. Mm-hmm. Very well used. Scarily, probably very much dug up, so.
Yep, it's a place that has had some, let's say, some injuries done to it.
Is that common to find things like that that are injured?
And sites that have been partly disturbed? Oh, yeah, it's more common to find sites like that than to find something that's...
And are they recoverable? Are they salvageable?
It really depends, but some of them certainly are. And some sites will really surprise you. You just don't think there could possibly be anything there. And just one example, quick example, we did a project at the Springfield Armory. This is not an ancient site, but underneath the building where the Garand M1 rifle was manufactured. Big, huge concrete floor, used as a warehouse in recent years. They demolished it to make a parking lot. And when they pulled up the concrete floor, they found that they had constructed the building by just putting down some fill, concrete over that, and it sealed all these features from late 1700s, barracks and storehouses for soldiers, World War I era features. They were all, you know, beautifully preserved under this floor of the building. So we found ancient Native American sites underneath railroad tracks. And you just don't think, how's there going to be a site preserved underneath this railroad track? They pulled up the tracks, they pulled off all the stone that the tracks were sitting on, and there was... They had just put it down right on the surface of the ground. There was a site underneath it. So I am no longer surprised when we find a site in a place that I didn't think there could possibly be one.
So after we do this survey and we look, let's say, 20 or 30 years into the future, what do you envision this would be like?
Oh, that's a great question. And what do I envision this to be like? I would like this to be a place where people can visit and walk around, and I would love to see some kind of interpretation, signage, or maybe something even more elaborate to tell people the story of this place and the people that live there. I would love to see that. And to have it be a place that people know about. Yes?
To be honest, it wasn't in the best interest of the people building the campground to bring up anything they might have dug up.
That's correct.
So a lot of stuff might have been...
And it's not really clear to me reading. I've been reading some old correspondence among Barker Keith and his archaeologist friends. And he said that, they told him to stop, and he stopped, and he was sure there was more out there. And then other people saying, well, the Massachusetts Archaeological Society never stopped until they had dug every last piece out of a place. But no, I don't think that's really true. I think you're right. When they saw what was going on, they may have told them enough. And they may not have wanted to dig it up themselves, but they just didn't want somebody out there digging while they had people at the campground.
There weren't the laws now. If you start a project now and you find bones, you have to stop and figure out what's going on. Back then, there weren't the laws to protect that property.
That's true. So if anyone's interested, there's this handy information sheet that the Mass Historical Commission puts out called Know-How Number 4. And this tells you exactly what to do if in a construction project, when it usually happens, sometimes erosion, you know, after a big storm, bones start falling out of a cut in the next to a stream. Exactly what to do if you find what you think are human remains. Because it's really important that people have a right to their final resting place. In the back?
In Ohio, there's a very large Adena site that they are excavating. They built a pavilion on this site, and they are doing a lot of excavating and analyzing of what was on the site. Is that something that could possibly be done, or is that?
That's something I would not want to do, because if there are people still buried there, I would want them to remain.
Okay.
And that's the the scope of work that we're working with does not allow us to dig up burials, and in any case, we wouldn't want to do that. Yes.
Considering the fact that wasn't always a lake, it used to be a river.
That it used to be a river?
Yes.
I'm not aware of that.
Man-made.
Quabog Pond is man-made. Is it man-enhanced or completely made?
There was a stone in there a long time ago, back in probably the late 70s, that someone was using for an anchor for the boat. It's somewhere in there. It's the water.
That's helping to hold the water level up? I was unaware of that. I'd always heard it was a natural pond.
It is.
It was a lot smaller.
It was smaller at one time. A lot of our ponds are, they were ponds, but they're bigger now than they were when somebody tried to turn a water wheel there. That's an interesting question, though. It might be something we could get at by looking at old maps. And thanks for that suggestion. Yes.
Do you know for sure that that's an Adena site? You said they traded their stone implements. There was trade, so you think that those stone implements could have come in from trade?
Yes, I think that is what happened.
Oh, you think?
I don't think it's a migration of Adena people Brookfield.
All right.
Or Quabog. I think it's trade.
Yeah. Okay.
But, time will tell. I think that, it's... At one time, archaeologists tried to explain everything by migration, and then that sort of fell out of favor. And certainly people have moved around North America since it was first settled. I mean, it's been, 15,000 or more years. And if you look at the way languages are distributed, it's really clear that there's been movements of people. And we know that people came down from Canada into New Mexico and Arizona, in ancient times, or not that ancient even. So people do move, but I think what we're seeing here in Brookfield and in the sort of individual finds that have been reported around Massachusetts, not many of them, that what we're looking at is trade. And objects moving hand to hand. Now they do find their way into burials, but I think that's a very widespread, not just in North America, but all over the world, where special exotic objects, they're special. And so they are buried with their owners.
So this is not probably an Adena site, but an Adena era site?
Right, well, it was Barker titled his paper, an Adena-Connected site. So it's called an Adena-Connected or an Adena-Related site. So it's still very interesting to find these objects here that we really know came from Ohio. The stone that those tubes that Barker found were made of is from Ohio. So they weren't local copies. And that's pretty remarkable. That's a long way for pieces to travel. During the next few centuries after Adena, trade really became incredible, especially in the Mississippi Valley. Stuff coming down from Yellowstone down into what is now the St. Louis area, moving up into the Great Lakes. Oh, that reminds me, one of the copper beads from one of the burials that Barker Keith found was analyzed
and found to have come from the Great Lake, a Great Lakes copper source. So that material moved a long distance before finally coming to rest here in Brookfield.
So what's the time frame of this Adena-Connected site?
It would be from about 1000 BC to about 100 AD. So 3000 years ago to 1900 years ago.
The pool, is that where you first hit, where they first hit burials? Or?
I don't think it was the pool, but I think the pool is west of where Barker was digging.
So there was nothing found where the pool was?
Well, I don't know about that. I really don't know about that. I mean, it's on that raised area. So anything up there, I think, you know, at one time, I mean, before the swimming pool was put in, that's an area I would say that would have high archaeological potential. Not even necessarily for burials, but as a living area. And not even necessarily for that time period, but, you know, it could go back, you know, 10,000 years or more. That's possible. Yes?
Would anybody in this room know where the Quabog Dairy was on that general vicinity within a quarter of a mile of that? It operated from 1910 to 1930-ish. Quabog Dairy.
Can you point it out on a map?
No, I have a bottle.
Oh, you've got a bottle.
A lost milk bottle. Cool. Quabog Dairy, and I've been told it was across the street from where those condos, where the apartments are. I don't know whether they're condos or not. No, the apartments are.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we will be able to shed some light on that in our research. If we do, we'll type. But if you could point out that location where you think it was on the map, you know, we can certainly, something I'd be happy to keep that in mind. That sounds really interesting.
So do you want to go through the phases, or do you want?
The schedule of the project?
Yeah.
I don't know if I can go through it off the top of my head.
Well, okay. Between now and March?
Yeah, between now and March, we're going to be continuing to do what we call background research. So we're not going to be digging out here until, you know, probably might not even be till after March. Yeah. Right now, it doesn't look feasible for the next few weeks at least. So we're going to be collecting information. The more information we can get on this property specifically, you know, the better we can hone our plan of where we're going to test. Because, you know, we don't have time and money to dig up the whole place. So we have to, you know, have a really good idea that where we're going to dig is going to give us the information we're looking for. So the more specific information we can get as to, you know, what's under there, or, you know, what's been noticed at similar kinds of places around the lake. I mean, all of that might be something that could help us.
So you have, I'm sorry, so you have no thermal imaging at these grave sites where you're going to dig them up. In other words, how far down are you going to go? I know you said you're going to talk.
Yeah.
What was the question?
The question was, like, how far down are we going to dig? I guess the answer I would give in general is as shallow as possible. If we don't find anything, we may go down farther, just to get an idea of, you know, what the soil profile looks like there. But if we find anything like disturbed, a disturbed area that's, you know, a big oval or, you know, grave shaft in shape, we're not going to dig into it. We're just going to map it in place. So it probably will be very shallow, because I believe that a lot of the soil
in there is very, it's a very shallow soil. A lot of the topsoil has been taken off. And Barker himself, I think, wrote about finding stuff that are just a few inches below the surface. Now, it may be different now. I mean, it's 30 years, 40 years later.
Disturbing grave sites. These people deserve to rest in peace.
Right.
And I would hate to see them be disturbed by going
right
deeper than you have to.
Right. We don't want to do that. So we're going to proceed very carefully. And the other thing we're going to do is when we have an area that we suspect may contain burials, we're going to start from outside of it and work our way towards it with narrow excavations, carefully peeling off the topsoil. Now, before we get to an area that has graves, we're going to be able to know how deep we need to go just to get this site of the next layer of soil. So that way I'm confident that we can avoid getting into the actual grave soil. That's our plan.
So if you do happen to hit a grave site, will you stop?
Absolutely.
That's right there.
Yeah.
That tells you what to do.
Yeah, we stop.
Because in my own research, even from the past, a grave site would be no deeper than 24 inches. Mm-hmm. It would stop even before that, though.
Yeah, because we could see the top of
the
grave shaft was dug from. Right. Yeah, so, you know, I mean, I don't even want to get into the grave shaft soil.
Yeah, no.
But because they were dug down at least a couple feet, mm-hmm. probably more. And you know, depending on how much has already been lost off the top from erosion and traffic and whatnot, I think we'll be able to identify the very top of the grave shaft and not go into it.
Okay.
That's our plan.
Because we talked before.
Yeah, we talked about it, and I think that. And did you talk to Mass Historical or?
Because I'm on the historical commission here. I'm on the historical commission here.
Yeah, about
Mass Historical.
And they don't want to cause harm to any of the graves.
Right.
Can you talk about grave shaft, talking vertical or horizontal?
A vertical grave shaft, but it has a horizontal plan to it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So we'll see the top of it. We'll see the horizontal plan. We'll see the boundary between where the grave shaft was dug and outside the grave shaft where the soil is not disturbed.
You can also tell if fill was put in too, right?
We should, as soon as we start digging, we should be able to pretty quickly tell whether we're digging in fill. And a lot of sites do have a layer of fill, you know, landscaping fill, whatever. My feeling is that not a lot of them.
They wanted level, so they had dug or fill to get level. You know, if anything was low, they had to fill it in. You know, we can't put a camper on a slope.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's a pretty flat area, but that may be something that we'll find, layers of fill, just put in to level things off. That's usually pretty easy to recognize.
So it's very encouraging, the tone and the theme of this meeting. I have a question for Clarence. Is the town committed to protecting this site?
Right now, absolutely. I mean, with what we know, we have to protect.
Is there pressure to put it into the tax rolls?
And maybe before you got here, Rudy, one of the reasons that we started this thing is could we put the property back in the tax roll? Once we understood from what Barker Keep found, it's very hard to see that this property could ever be placed into the tax rolls.
I mean, so there is a commitment from the town meetings and from the town meeting as well?
Well, from town meeting, you committed $17,000 to match mm-hmm. the Mass Historical money of $17,000 to do the investigation. With what we know now, we may be able to get one of the things that has been of interest because of down on Pine Lane and the access into Pine Lane is very difficult for fire vehicles or those kinds of things. We might, in working with Eric, be able to identify and get understand where we might be able to put an access way in that would also fit with the idea of the the idea of additional access, emergency access and the like. But I mean, that's really probably the extent that we'd be able to talk. I mean, and again, we have a representative from the Blue Trail group, and what they're already doing is looking and mapping, you know, the Quaybar. Again, the campground is right there as far as where there might want to be a stop lot on the Blue Trail. And again, I think we need to work with that organization to understand how we've come together. We learned earlier, Eric shared with us earlier, of another grant source where we could in fact work towards an interpretive site. So at least we could get people coming into town and investing in the town and spending money in the town, so that in fact we could get some return from this. But I think it's going to move down that path rather than any house lots or anything.
Would the town's future land use be contingent upon your succeeding in finding a new burial site? Or is it enough that Barker was able to identify that in 1965? Do you have to find something new for the town to be able to
recognize as a burial ground?
Yeah, for the town to make that decision.
I don't know if I'm the best person to answer that question because I'm not a lawyer, but I would think that it is a burial ground. Burials have been found there. What we're hoping to do is get more fine-grained information on what's there, and that's going to help the town. You know, if you want to build an access road, maybe we can clear by excavating, not finding anything, an area there. Maybe protective measures could be put, a layer of clean fill be put on top to protect any sensitive features or even burials that are underneath it. I don't think putting an access road over a burial ground is what we want to do. But if we're concerned about other kinds of archaeological features, then that's something that can be done. There's lots of ways of protecting sites. But the more information you can get about what's out there and where it is, the better you can protect it.
How are we doing? We're good? So what we would like to do to start to close up the meeting is, if you have additional stuff that you'd like to confer with Kit or Eric, we're going to be here so that we can share. And Andre, we really appreciate you being here. I have a photographer, I believe, from Worcester here who would like to see some of your stuff. Maybe others would like to see some of your stuff. So what we'll do is we'll gather around the table and kibitz and whatnot. For closing, anything else closing from your point?
I brought business cards, and I will put a stack of them on the table, and also my number, so that you can email me or phone me if you have any information you'd like to share. There's also email information on here on an email address that doesn't get a lot of use.
Clarence, could you just, for the group here, just confirm the timeline we talked about?
Okay, so March would be finishing up the investigation kinds of things. Then the ground thaws, and Eric and Kit can be doing their work on the site based on the ground being unthawed. Basically, June time frame, the investigative sort of stuff has to be pretty much done. And by September 15th, we have to submit all of our stuff, including the National Historical material.
Nomination
by
There's
April.
A lot to do.
By September 15th to kind of take care of this piece. What's important about this is, having finished that in September, we need to then regroup and decide what's next.
Eric, could you give us your thoughts on the uniqueness of this site as opposed to the whole state, the whole area?
I think this is a uniquely rich area in general. I mean, it's just got a lot to recommend it to indigenous people, either hunter-gatherers or farmers, and it's near transportation, both trails and rivers. It's got shallow water, it's got deep water, it's got wetlands, it's got rocky hills, it's just got about every kind of environment in Massachusetts, you know, right here. So I think it's a really superb area, and I'm not surprised that so many archaeological sites have been found here. And I think it's a uniquely beautiful area, too. When I did the inventory Barker Keith's collection, I loved coming out here. I didn't know anything about this place. But then I came back later and went fishing and really, really enjoyed it. And I think the archaeology is very special, too. And it's really, you know, a lot of it was done before things changed a lot. Before there were professional archaeologists. Before there was a different attitude about treating graves. And so it would be nice to have some archaeological research done with new techniques and new ways of recording, professional crew, and with an attitude of protection rather than excavation. So I think this is a really nice step in learning about the past here in the Quabog area. And I'm really glad that the town has pulled this together. This is really exciting. And it's wonderful to be working for a community instead of a developer. A lot, we do contract archaeology, and a lot of the people that we work for, they just want to build something and, you know, have us do our work, and they don't even care. They don't want to read the report or anything. So it's really nice to have an opportunity to work with people who want to protect the site and learn more about it and have a really positive attitude toward it. And I hope that we can continue to work that way. Really excited about this project.
Yes, Emerson.
Yeah, you mentioned early on in the meeting that there was remains that were found there, and they went to the Springfield Museum. Mm-hmm. You just stated that they were repatriated someplace. So
yeah, reinterred.
Why they didn't come back to Brookfield, or why they wouldn't help with Brookfield?
The procedure for repatriation involves museums. It's federal laws and regulations. Any museum that wants federal money has to follow this standard, and that's all museums pretty much, and Springfield among them. They have to publish a list of what they have, make it available to federally recognized tribes, and those tribes who are interested in it can then ask for both human remains and what they call funerary objects, that is anything buried with a person, to be returned. And then once they're returned, it's up to the tribes to do, to dispose of them as they see fit. And in this case, the New England tribes, the federally recognized tribes, typically work together on these repatriates. Was the Webster landmark involved in that at all? No.
Not federally recognized.
No, are you, but sometimes are you able to sort of get involved with those?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so they do have a place where those remains are reburied. It's not a published location because they want to keep it protected. But those, I was just asked over to the museum this week, and I was told that they have been reburied.
One of the things another learning, and this is separate from archaeology, is what we learned is the local clan is not a federally recognized entity. And so one of the things that we need to be thinking about, and again, working with the local indigenous population, is to understand what we should and should not be doing to really kind of promote recognition, because it's sad to have learned what we learned.
And to work with you instead of
against
ignoring your interests.
So,
what do I want to say? So federal recognition is an impossible task these days. The Nipmuc tribe, the Eastern Nipmuc tribe, Nipmuc Nation, had federal recognition for one day, the last day of the Bill Clinton administration. They were granted federal recognition. The first day of the Bush administration, it was taken away. And the reason was not because of the adequacy of the research that established that they had a long continuity of genealogy and presence on the land, and they own this piece of land in Grafton that has never been owned by non-Native people. It was politics. It was about Connecticut not wanting another casino. So it's a process that, and this is after spending a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of effort, and really, you know, blood, sweat, and tears to get this done, and, you know, and to have it derailed by political considerations. So it's a very difficult process, especially in the eastern United States. Out west, it's different. A lot more tribes are recognized, but it's very hard for the tribes in the east. So what a lot of the smaller tribes have been able to do is work with the federally recognized tribes to sort of step in for them when there's artifacts or human remains that they're interested in.
Doesn't happen that often.
It doesn't happen that often. So, you know, that's another process that isn't easy.
So to kind of, unless somebody else says something, well, I'm going to finish up with two stories. Okay. And then what we'll do is those that want to come forward, want to leave. Great. We really appreciate you coming. on the flip side, we got something more.
What, you got supper waiting for you?
Exactly.
And there's a sign-in sheet with anyone who's interested.
Yeah, make sure you sign.
Being kept abreast of what's going on, and if you have additional information, we can get in touch with you. And if you want some help, we'll get in touch with you as well. That's right up here.
So two quick stories. So a friend of mine gave me a magazine subscription, and I opened the Smithsonian magazine last month, wherever it is here, and I opened it up to this thing in Greece. Well, guess what? This was happening in Greece at the same time things that we're talking about were happening here. Maybe it's our turn for a Smithsonian article. And now for one last fun thing, and Kermit, you're going to hate me for this, but I have to tell the story. So Kermit was walking the site with my friend Tom. And there was a certain event that did happen. And so this is our little ghost story. And Kermit knows the story of the hair standing up on the back of his neck. So we may know where some folks are buried. You know, all we're going to do is take Kermit down and show you where he ran off.
We walked over it, and I remember you talking about that. So we'll definitely, that's worth knowing, recording.
So we'll close this portion. We'll close this portion of the meeting unless there's something going on. And if you have more information for Eric or Kit, please come forward and we'll catch that at that time as well. Thank you. I much appreciate you coming this evening.